We're going to go ahead and get started. I'm Sue Desmond-Hellmann, and I'm Chancellor here at UCSF, and very, very happy to welcome all of you. And please take a seat. We have had an incredibly spectacular day, and the spectacular day was listening to Great Science over in Genentech Hall from the 2013 Breakthrough Prize winners. And you're in for a treat with the panel of the 2014 Breakthrough Prize winners. But before we start this afternoon's festivities, I want to call on somebody who's in this audience, because this whole Breakthrough Prize is the idea of Yuri Milner. And I still remember less than a year ago when Yuri called me and said, "Susan, I can't do an imitation of you, Yuri. I just won't do it justice. We've got a big surprise, and I need your help." Mm-hmm. And you can imagine, in less than 2 minutes after I heard the help that was needed for UCSF to host the first Breakthrough Prize ceremonies, which we did in Genentech Hall, It was an absolute yes. And the concept and the idea of having heroes such as the ones you see to my left and the ones that many of you heard today just seemed somewhat audacious with a $3 million prize, but really lovely. And I can tell you that I almost feel like a person who's eaten too much and has indigestion, science indigestion, from all these talks, because I'm still processing them. But it was magnificent and really a testament to the vision that Yuri has and had. So I want to call on Yuri Milner for us to acknowledge Yuri and to ask him to say a couple things to start us off this evening. Yuri.
Susan, you actually wanted to tell the story, so you've stolen my whole speech here, so it will be much shorter. I just want to thank Susan, in particular, and UCSF and the team for organizing this event. And I also want to thank sponsors. You know, we are in this together with Mark Zuckerberg and Priscilla Chen and Sergey Brin and Anne Wojcicki. And this year we've been joined by Jack Ma, the founder of Alibaba, the largest Chinese internet company, and his wife, Kathy Zhang. So it's really a growing group of people. I hope it will continue to grow. Though we need to keep the balance between the number of people that we award every year, otherwise we'll run out of candidates. But speaking seriously, I think it's important that this prize is really awarded by the peers. The way it works is that previous winners vote for the new ones. So the people that you have heard earlier today, they have voted the new prize winners in, and then they will join the ranks of the selection committee, and the committee will grow over time, but they will continue to select subsequent winners. So I think it's important because it's a pure sort of peer recognition without any influence on the side of sponsors. So Susan, back to you, and good luck with the panel.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So let me just take two more minutes and acknowledge two other people. One is Art Levinson, who is the chair of the selection committee. And I think that the quality of the talks we heard today and the quality of the folks up on this panel speak to Art's wisdom in the selection process. And Jeff Bluestone, those of you who know about academic administration know that when I say, "Oh, Yuri asked me to put on the event," what that really means, which is I call the provost and say, "Jeff, help." So Jeff Bluestone and Kathy Hollenbach and Genevieve Bonville made today happen. And I particularly want to acknowledge Jeff. Thank you very much. So we heard a lot today about the past, and that discussion about the past and anchoring many of the talks into the history of the science involved was incredibly inspiring, and I want to shift gears for this panel and talk about the future. And so I'm going to ask each of our panelists to talk about something that is always hard to do, which is to predict the future, but to anchor their comments about the future in the work that they've been recognized for. And obviously, we only have an hour and a half, and I want to leave time for all of you to ask questions in addition to me asking questions and allowing the panel to ask questions or disagree with each other. So I will be brief in my introductions, but I'm going to start with Robert S. Langer. And he received his bachelor's degree from Cornell and a science degree in chemical engineering from MIT. Then worked for Judah Folkman, who we heard about today, in cancer research at Children's Hospital and Harvard Medical School. Currently, he is the David H. Koch Institute Professor at MIT and runs the largest biomedical engineering lab in the world. He's written over 1,200 articles, has over 500 patents issued worldwide, and has won too many awards for me to name all of them. But I love this quote from him. His proudest accomplishment is teaching some 500 students and postdocs, now professors and startup leaders themselves, and he organizes pizza and soda sessions to make himself accessible to his undergrad students. But more importantly, he's a one-finger typist and never did his daughter's homework, he claims. So Bob, help us think about what you're being recognized for today, and congratulations. And what are you most excited about and your predictions for what the next 5 to 10 year horizon will bring to your field?
Sure. Well, thank you very much, Susan. Well, so just to tell you a little bit about myself, I mean, so everybody that's winning this award is just, in my opinion, just a world famous biologist or clinician. I'm actually very different. I'm an engineer. I'm a chemical engineer. And so I do stuff at the interface between engineering and medicine. And I guess that's what I got this for in terms of designing new drug delivery systems and new materials that you could use in the human body. So maybe I'll just pick a couple of areas to mention where I think the future of that's going. One of them, I think, is in the area of nanotechnology. And let me go over why that might be important. There's a lot of new drugs that people are trying to develop, and we heard sort of the basis for a lot of that this morning. And but these drugs might be ways to shut off RNA, like siRNA, or maybe you do the opposite, like give mRNA, or maybe DNA. But one of the biggest challenges is getting them into the cells. And generally, you want something that's fairly small, maybe under 200 nanometers, to help take it into the cell if you want to have reasonable quantities get there. So creating the right kind of nanoparticles that could deliver things to target specific cells is one area that I think will be important. I also think that nanotechnology will be important in other areas, like in terms of new imaging techniques, so that you could maybe detect things like cancer earlier. And just to give another example, even in new diagnostics, like we've been working with some others at MIT and Mass General and started a local company where it's kind of trying to make a tiny NMR machine. So if you right now want to, say, detect certain problems, let's say you have a blood infection, sometimes it takes up to 5 days to get an answer back, you know, when you're trying to detect a blood infection because people have to, you know, culture the cells and try to grow out the organisms and so forth. But some of the things that we're working on, there was a paper published in Science Translational Medicine last year, are ways of creating nanoparticles that might have magnets in them, and then you could decorate them with molecules that could detect things in the blood. And if you are detecting the thing you want, then they would aggregate, and you'd get a different what's called T2 signal. So you'd get a different signal. And by doing it, you could actually get an analysis, say, in that case, rather than 5 days, you'd get in 2 hours. And that would totally change the kind of treatment. You could also assume if you could get a result in 2 hours, maybe before, maybe you could get it in a minute or two. So rather than have to wait at the for a while in terms of trying to see your diagnosis using certain types of nanotechnology, you might be able to get it extremely rapidly. So that's one example. A totally different example, I think, might be what I'll call smart microchips, or things that you could swallow or implant in the human body. And these might be tiny little systems that might have little wells in them, and they'd have little covers. And they'd have, you could put the same drug and underneath the little covers, or you could literally have a pharmacy on a chip if the drugs are potent enough. And then what you could actually do, and we've actually done this even in early stage human trials, you could, by remote control, open up any one of those wells. You could actually send a signal by radio frequency, like the same way you open a garage door. You could make these wells open. And so the idea is that, you know, like, for example, Charles Sawyers this morning talked about cancer, how you'd like to someday maybe give multiple drugs. Well, this would be actually one way that you might be able to do that. You could actually send signals, and you could actually, and your computer, or it could be a wristwatch-like device or anything, you know, it would collect all the information. You'd know when you took the drug. You'd know what drugs you took. If you wanted to, I think someday you could actually reprogram it to do other things. And also, someday, I think you could put sensors on these chips so you could detect signals in the human body and then tell your little system how much drug to deliver. And then the third area I wanted to mention, actually, and Dr. Yamanaka talked about this some, is regenerative medicine and tissue engineering. From the engineering side, what we are trying to do is take materials that you could design and combine them, say, with stem cells or combine them with other cells and make new tissues and organs. You can already make human skin that way, but someday, and I agree with what he said in terms of the time frames, but someday I think we will be able to make a whole variety of different tissues and organs. Already we see things like cartilage and bladders and corneas and in human clinical trials, and I think over the next 20 to 50 years, I think we'll see all kinds of tissues and organs being in clinical trials, and hopefully many of them being used to help patients.
Terrific. Thank you very much. To Bob's left is Alexander Varshavsky from Caltech, who is being honored for discovering critical molecular determinants and biological functions of intracellular protein degradation. I love the story of his immigration to the United States in 1977 after training at Moscow University with the help of friends, apparently under circumstances worthy of a spy novel. So we'll have to ask him about that later. He joined the biology department of MIT a month later after being invited to give an impromptu seminar that so impressed the faculty that he was offered an assistant professorship on the spot. And he said, "I was a faculty member of the MIT before I knew exactly what grants were, and before the colleagues who hired me became aware of that fact," which I think is perfect. After 15 years at MIT, he moved his lab to Caltech to become the Howard and Gwen Laurie Schmitz Professor of Cell Biology. He's received a number of awards, including the Lasker. And I'll pose the same question to you, Alex. Tell us a little bit about how your work now can be put into context of what you're most excited about for the next decade.
Thank you very much, Susan, and I greatly appreciate the honor of this award and being here together with you today. I wanted to say two things. One of them will be about the field I'm in, but the other thing would be seemingly about a different subject, and I will try to make it quickly. But it's actually about the same thing. So the field is about how and why cells destroy their own proteins. Many years ago, when we started this work, more than three decades ago, actually in the early 80s, it was known that proteins can be destroyed inside living cells, but it was mostly viewed as a damage control operation because it was clear that proteins eventually are destroyed partly because they get damaged, but that was largely how it was perceived. And in part through our work in the 80s and later on, it became clear that nothing could be further from the truth, because it turns out that the ubiquitin system, which is really the focus of our work in the lab over these three decades, permeates just about every corner of the cell and does literally everything that the cell does. Without exaggerating, because even transcriptional regulation, that is regulation of how genes are expressed, is done indirectly through degradation of transcriptional factors by the ubiquitin system. So there is this complete feedback and tremendously complicated and very important role that this system plays in the cell. To give you an idea of complexity of this system, which will probably occupy a few more generations of scientists after us, roughly 10% of the entire coding capacity of the genome involves directly or indirectly components of the ubiquitin system. It's one of the largest systems in the cell. And so we are continuing to study it, and of course one can predict tremendous things about it in the next 10 years or so in the area of fundamental understanding, which will go on and on because the system is so huge and complex and important. In the area of applications, of course, because drugs based on different specific targets of the ubiquitin system will continue to increase in importance as time goes on. Every major pharmaceutical company has departments devoted to development of drugs against or for specific components of the ubiquitin system. So all that will continue, and it goes without saying, and there is no way for me to even single out a specific subject. Instead, what I would like to do in the next two, three minutes, I hope at most, is to tell you about something that I'm recently fascinated by, and it's seemingly not connected to the ubiquitin system. It's one of the problems that I occasionally think about in between talks or in between doing other things. And that is the following. All of you know that eukaryotic cells consist of the cytoplasm, topologically speaking, cytoplasm and the nucleus. And the nucleus is a compartment where chromosomes are and where ribosomes, that is, molecular machines that translate messenger RNA into proteins, mature and are initially made. And then they're transported to the cytoplasm where they function. The question is, are ribosomes ever actually active inside the nucleus? Or to put it differently in the more conventional language, is there such thing as translation in the nucleus? Now, if you go to textbooks, they will say, no, no, no. There is no such thing. Okay? All translation, to the best of anybody's current understanding, including mine, takes place in the cytoplasm, in the cytosol, as they say. Okay, that is the area of cytoplasm outside membrane-enclosed compartments. Okay, it turns out that there is a growing, slowly growing, non-definitive, far from definitive, but fascinating to me, evidence that maybe translation does take place in the nucleus. Molecular biology became a fairly mature subject over the last several decades. From the time when you could just see a gold nugget on the surface of the Earth and pick it up, okay? Now you have to use fairly sophisticated equipment, large teams of people very often, to get those nuggets, because that's a sign of a growing maturity of the field. But there are still fundamental basic problems in the field that can be stated simply, just like some mathematical propositions that defied solutions for hundreds of years, but have not been solved. And one of them is this simple question. Is there translation in the nucleus? It turns out that there are papers about it, that if there is translation in the nucleus, the ubiquitin system would be involved in a major way, obviously, probably quality control, all kinds of things. There are some fundamental reasons to suspect, obviously not think, because there is no proof, to suspect that there is a pioneer run of some kind of ribosome in the nucleus that does translation. And if any one of you is curious enough about the subject and Googles nuclear translation tonight, you will find a few recent papers about it. None of them bad, but none of them definitive. So it's really one of those problems that you would like to solve yourself. And I have some ideas about it, but I don't think I have really good ideas about it. So it's a perfect example of a wide open, basic, fundamental problem that touches probably most of biology, because nuclear translation would be an exceedingly fundamental insight if it is true. Proving that it doesn't happen is even more difficult, because it's very difficult to prove a negative. But proving a positive might be positive, possible. And this is actually one example of a problem that I think would be terrific to solve, that will change quite a few things. And molecular biology, despite its relative maturity, is still full of such problems. And that's basically what I wanted to say.
Thank you, Dr. Barshofsky, for throwing down the gauntlet. So terrific. Thank you so much. The next person who got this recognition for 2014 is Michael Hall of the University of Basel in Switzerland for his discovery of the target of rapamycin, TOR, and its role in cell growth control. Now, you know, at UCSF, we like to claim our alums, and Dr. Hall is one of our very, very honored alums. He got his undergraduate degree from the University of North Carolina and his PhD from Harvard University, but spent 6 years at UCSF as a postdoc fellow with Ira Herskowitz, and I'm told took over half of Herb Boyer's lab at one point in time. He then joined the University of Basel in 1987, where he's currently professor and former chairman of biochemistry. He also served as vice director of BioCentrum from 2008 to 2009. And he's received a number of prizes, including the Marcel Benoit Prize, sometimes called the Swiss Nobel Prize. I like this quote to him from him. He said, "I think I've always had a kind of contrarian spirit. That's just his style to counter the prevailing dogma," says Scott Emer of Cornell University in Ithaca and a former lab mate of his. And one fun fact is that he grew up in South America, where as a child, he established his own lab in the backyard. "There was this old rundown shack that I painted white and painted lab on the door," he says, "but the only experiment I really did there was to make gunpowder." So keep that in mind if you enter his lab. Yes. So I'll ask you the same question in light of your discovery and the work you're being recognized for on tour. How do you see what's exciting in the next 10 years?
Well, thank you. First of all, TOR is a, I should define what TOR is in case someone doesn't know. TOR is a kinase, a highly conserved kinase. It's also, more importantly, a central controller of cell growth. And by cell growth, I mean it controls the size of cells, the change in size of cells. For example, if you go to the gym and work out and your muscles get bigger, it's because individual cells get bigger. And this is controlled by TOR. But this is just one example. There are many examples how TOR controls cell growth. Now, when we discovered TOR a little over 20 years ago, the term cell growth was used to refer to increase in cell number, not increase in cell size. This is hard to believe from the perspective of today, because cell growth is, of course, a very fundamentally important process. In those days, cell growth was thought to be a random process. If there were nutrients available, in other words, building blocks available, cells grew. If there weren't, cells didn't grow. And the term growth was used to refer to increase in cell number. So when we isolated TOR, we thought we were actually studying increase in cell number, cell division. And at that time, the mechanism to control cell division was being worked out. Eventually won the Nobel Prize in 2000. And it was very clear that as that mechanism was being worked out, there was no room for TOR in there. There was just no reason for TOR to be involved. And we were stumped. What could TOR be doing? We, of course, didn't consider cell growth because cell growth was thought not to be controlled. So we finally decided that by a long process of elimination, that maybe it does indeed control cell growth, and that cell growth thus is indeed controlled, actively controlled. And this was a revelation. This completely changed our outlook, and from then on, things got much easier. Then we realized TOR controls cell growth in response to nutrients by activating a whole array of anabolic processes, or inhibiting a whole array of catabolic processes like ubiquitin-dependent protein degradation. So over the last 10 years, I would say, after understanding TOR controlled cell growth, we've made great strides, our lab and a number of other labs around the world, in understanding how TOR controls cell growth, autonomous cell growth. And I think we have a very good idea about this now. We have, you know, the inputs, the outputs, the whole circuit. But now I think we have to move on to a new area, and there's a greater level of complexity here. And this stems from an experiment done by Pierre Leopold, who's a fly geneticist. And he was looking for mutant flies, which were defective in growth, had growth defects. And he isolated a mutant, had a TOR defect, in one tissue, and only in one tissue. It was the fat body of the fly, which is like the liver of the fly. And based on everything we knew up until that point, we predicted that the liver cells would be all smaller and the liver would be smaller, but the rest of the fly would be the normal size because the defect was specific to the liver. But the major surprise, the big discovery, was that the whole fly was smaller and proportionately smaller. So everything, there was a system-level regulation of cell growth. So there was a TOR-dependent control of growth between organs to control growth over a whole body plan. Somehow the body knew exactly how big to make each tissue so that they all end up being properly proportioned. So the lung was the right size compared to the liver, et cetera, et cetera. So this suddenly opened up a whole new area. What are the mechanisms which control growth over a whole body plan, and what's the role of TOR in this? And I think this is the next frontier we have to approach. How is TOR controlling growth of a whole body so that everything's properly proportioned, building up from how growth of single cells is controlled? I think this is something we have to start understanding. At the moment, I think we have to approach this in mice. We can do this in flies, but I think this is an important frontier. And of course, it'll have implications in many areas. I think we heard a lot about organoids this morning. I think if you want to take that to its logical conclusion, we'll make not only organoids, but maybe organisms. This is far, far in the future. But this also has to be all properly proportioned. So this is really very futuristic, but I think TOR is going to be playing a role there. We have to think about that. Another area I'm particularly interested in is more medically related, and that is that, as we also heard this morning, there are a number of targeted cancer therapies available, and whereas they provide short-term benefit, they don't really work on the long term. We are not curing cancer. And this is because, as we heard this morning, there are evasive mechanisms of resistance. The tumor cells, acquire adaptive resistance or evasive resistance. And it's also come out, perhaps not surprisingly, because TOR is a controller of cell growth, that these evasive mechanisms, which allow tumor cells to evade cancer therapies, involve TOR and TOR signaling pathways. So we have to understand what the relationship is between these TOR pathways and the pathways which are targeted by these specific targeted therapies. And then once we understand that, then we can do things like combined therapies, as we also heard about this morning. So there's also a lot to be learned which will pay off in the clinics.
Terrific. Thank you. Malon DeLong of Emory University is recognized for defining the interlocking circuits in the brain that malfunction in Parkinson's disease. This scientific foundation underlies the circuit-based treatment of Parkinson's disease by deep brain simulation. Dr. DeLong is the William Timmy Professor of Neurology at Emory. He received his undergrad degree here at Stanford and his medical degree from Harvard University. He has, again, received numbers of awards, including the 2009 American Academy of Neurology Movement Disorders Research Award. And he's taken care of Muhammad Ali, whose wife, Lonnie, said of Dr. DeLong, "As both a dear friend and one of the world's leading neuroscientists, Dr. DeLong tirelessly pursues scientific progress with compassion and conviction." Now, if you want to know something fun about him, he was one of only five campers who persevered for the entire 10-day wilderness trek of a hunter-gatherer survival course in which the group subsisted primarily on nuts, cactus flowers, and prickly pears, including eating grasshoppers. But I guess he says after they're roasted, they're not bad at all. I think you must have been pretty hungry, Dr. DeLong, at the time. So tell our audience about your work, and even more importantly, what do you see on the horizon for patients with Parkinson's and movement disorders?
Well, thank you. It's really a great honor to be here and receive an award, but also to think about the work, the times, progress, and kind of future considerations. I'm going to say just a few words because I know many of you are familiar with the things we're talking about, but they're very different from most of the molecular genetic things we've been talking about today. And so we're dealing really in the brain, with the brain at the network level, systems, if you will. And my beginnings really were at the NIH in the laboratory of somebody you may know, but should hear, is Ed Everts, who was really a pioneer in this field, who really took single cell recording and behaving primates to a new level. And I was really very lucky to go to his lab and spend 5 years of my life solely focused on the basal ganglia and what the basal ganglia do. It was an interesting time to arrive in the lab because I got there late, and it turns out most of the places, the parts of the brain had been taken by others. The motor cortex, you know, the motor cortex, frontal eye fields, the cerebellum, what's left, thalamus? No. Basal ganglia. So it was basal ganglia. I was actually very happy about that, but that was how it happened.
Like it worked out okay.
That was how it happened, yeah. So yeah, sure, it was a gold mine. And at the time I arrived, the basal ganglia were really sort of mysterious structures at the base of the brain, connected with the cortex and thalamus, but even people talked about extrapyramidal systems and all kinds of ideas, and thought that the basal ganglia were there to take input from all the cortical areas and process that and send that resulting action command, if you will, to the motor structures, to the motor area of the cortex, and then a movement would be initiated. So they were kind of a funnel to behavior. So we began working recording activity of cells and found that the body representation was preserved throughout the basal ganglia. And so the arm area was preserved all the way through body parts. And I began to think, well, there's no real funneling here. This is interesting. And over the years, really began to realize that wasn't the pattern, that really, what we found is that the motor area was very circumscribed. It was discrete. There was a motor domain, and then there was a non-motor domain that was quite large. And we came to realize that other non-motor area was involved with cognitive executive function and with what we call limbic, sort of emotional mood regulation, perhaps, and reward, those different aspects. So there were these functional domains that were quite separate. And so came up with the notion that the basal ganglia were really circuits, components of these separated, parallel circuits. So you could have parallel processing of all these cortical functions rather than funneling, parallel processing. And we came to study Parkinson's because of the arrival of an animal model that was the MP2P primate model, which was a good replica of the disease in terms of the symptomatology and signs. And that model gave us real insight into the changes that were occurring within the network. The network, not on the slide, but through the cortical, through the basal ganglia, the different nodes of the basal ganglia and the different, we talked about direct and indirect pathways, some of you may know those. But what we found was that the activity was increased, very abnormal in patterning and bursting and oscillation. So it was really messed up. So the idea was, let's see what happens if we interrupt it. Simple idea. And lesioned the subthalamic nucleus in the monkey model of Parkinson's disease. And this was the aha moment, the second one in my life, but that was an amazing, instantaneous abolition of tremor, rigidity, and slowness of movement on the opposite side of the body. So this was a powerful message that the abnormality that loss of dopamine was producing was a circuit network disturbance that could be corrected by interruption, simple interruption of that with a cell selective toxin. That led us to do pallidotomies in patients, and we did that for about 5 years. We went one node down in the network and found it very effective. And then when deep brain stimulation was introduced, it had been introduced by allambenabid for tremor in the thalamus. And when we discovered this subthalamic target, of course, the natural thing was to do that. And as many of you know, the subthalamic nucleus is now the target that is most commonly used for treating Parkinson's disease. And so, 1,000 questions. How does interruption of this network fix the problem? And how does stimulation, seems like the opposite, fix the problem, but actually does exactly the same clinically? You could not distinguish that. And to get into the details here would be inappropriate, but I think I know a little bit how it works, but there's a lot of controversy, and I would just say that probably we're overwriting. Much like a lesion is interrupting, we're overriding, canceling out abnormal patterning of activity by the stimulation. And realize that this is applied to an area several millimeters in diameter. This is a tiny piece of the brain. And so what we're doing is really stimulating not just cells, but fibers. And we're pretty sure about that part of it now. So we're stimulating a network, and we can now study this beyond the thalamus and even into the cortex. So what is the future of all this? As you know, it's not used just for Parkinson's, but for dystonia, for Tourette syndrome. It's being extended to, and tremor, of course, it's being extended to psychiatric disorders, depression. Obsessive compulsive disorder. These are, I think, best viewed as circuit disorders. They're circuit disturbances, and they're very reflecting this segregated organization of these neural networks. So the targets are still open. As you know, there's some work now even in Alzheimer's that has indicated some cognitive benefit with stimulation, not of these neural networks specifically, but of a subcortical network. A lot of things are happening. This field has been stagnant for, I would say, more than a decade. We have used simple, high-frequency, it has to be high-frequency stimulation. Turn it on, you know, adjust the amplitude and the pulse width, and let it go. Night and day. And that has worked actually quite well, and in a way it's probably been a obstacle to further innovation. But now with increasing competition among device manufacturers, this is really happening, and people are beginning to realize that there are some ways to really improve the efficacy of this, and I think this is where we're going. To other disorders and to refinements that are going to make a real difference, I think, in the efficiency and ease of doing these things. It's possible to operate with feet. Right now we're in an open loop sort of system, but a closed loop system would make a lot more sense and actually has been tried in experimental situations. So trigger your stimulator by the behavior, the needs of the moment in a closed-loop fashion. Modulating the pulse characteristics, the patterning, seems to be important and can lead to some real changes. The whole process can be done now, actually, without physiologic guidance, in a sense, relying heavily on the intraoperative MRI to place these stimuli. Or the leads. So this is going to get easier, I think, and more effective, and will be limited, I think, primarily by our ability to better understand these networks and how we're modulating them. And there are other targets as well for stimulation, because this is this is really stimulating networks, and there are more.
That's fantastic. Thank you so much. Next, Richard Lifton of Yale is being recognized for the discovery of genes and biochemical mechanisms that cause hypertension. He received his bachelor's degree from Dartmouth College and his MD and PhD degrees from Stanford University, trained in medicine at Brigham and Women's Hospital in Harvard prior to moving to Yale University in 1993, where he is chairman and Sterling Professor of Genetics and directs the Yale Center for Human Genetics and Genomics, and is an investigator of HHMI. He's had many awards, including the Wiley Prize in Biomedical Sciences. Working with patients to understand human disease and advancing knowledge and treatment is an enterprise of infinite fascination and reward, he's been quoted as saying. And one of the things that I'm inspired by is his quoting that he was inspired as a boy by President John F. Kennedy's call to public service. And when you think about the number of human beings on Earth who suffer from hypertension and its consequences, that is a call to public service. So how do you think about your work in the context of what the next decade will bring?
Thank you, Susan. First, it's a real thrill to be here today, and I want to thank everyone for the remarkable hospitality that UCSF has shown all of us. I'll start by acknowledging the difficulty of predicting events more than a couple of years over the event horizon, and I'll frame that by starting where I started down the road at Stanford almost 40 years ago. I read a paper in 1974 that came out of the biochemistry department in the early days of recombinant DNA, when people were thinking if I could just get my hands on a little bit of RNA from a specific gene, I'd be able to clone it and learn something about that gene. And I read a paper by Dave Hoeganis, who had a quite different conception. He really envisioned the idea that if we recognize genetic mutations in a simple organism like a fruit fly, we ought to be able to find what the molecular nature underlying that mutation was. And the strategy for this was developing a unified map of the physical and the genetic maps of the human genome. And I read that paper and I thought, that's the paradigm for the next generation, and that you could imagine how that would be applied ultimately to human genetics. And so I ran to Stanford as fast as I could and started working in Drosophila because that was the most tractable model system at the time. And I'll just point out that 40 years ago, we would have had no ability to predict what we can do today. And what we're doing today is so far beyond anything that I imagined 40 years ago. So if I think about what a first-year graduate student is thinking about today and thinking what the world is going to look like during the life of your scientific career, I think we really can't begin to imagine the developments that will ensue. Certainly, I never had the imagination to believe we'd be doing the things that we're doing today. So after coming out of clinical training, I thought an appropriate thing to do would be to try to use the tools that had come out of this work in model systems and apply it to humans. And I thought of one of the really important complex traits that was then unsolved, and that's hypertension. Hypertension at the time was believed to be either a primary disease of the brain, the heart, the adrenal gland, the kidney, or the vasculature. And I thought this was a good place to try to apply genetics. If we couldn't even decide what the primary organ was, we might be able to find rare outliers that were just like what we had done in developmental genetics in the fruit fly. And if we were successful in doing that on multiple occasions, we might be able to recognize the landscape that regulates blood pressure in the human population. So we can't do mutagenesis in humans, so we scoured the planet looking for extreme outliers in the natural population and identified extreme high and extreme low blood pressure, found which of these were caused by single gene mutations, and used the tools that were emerging to identify the underlying genes. And to our surprise, these genes were not scattered across the physiologic landscape, but converged on a single final common pathway that regulates the kidney's handling of salt. And all of the mutations that increased salt reabsorption raised blood pressure. All of the mutations that lowered salt reabsorption lowered blood pressure. And this has provided the scientific foundation for first efforts to prevent cardiovascular disease by lowering salt intake in the general population. 62 countries around the world now are advocating reduced consumption of salt as a mechanism of disease prevention. It's identified rational combination treatments, that combination therapies that focus on reducing salt balance as a mechanism of lowering blood pressure in the general population. And it's identified new targets for development of what should be best-in-class therapeutics that are in development in big pharma. So with that as a background and thinking about what the future holds, we now are so more advanced than where we were when I started in this area some 20 years ago. We now have the ability to, I think, on a to-do list, to think about we shouldn't be satisfied until we know the consequence of mutation of every gene in the human genome. We have the yeast knockout, we have the mouse knockout. We ought to understand the consequence to a living human being of loss of function mutation in all 21,000 protein coding genes in the human genome. And this is not a tall order. We ought to be able to achieve this. We ought to then be able to begin to understand which of these genes are potentially attractive targets for therapeutic intervention and devise approaches to exploit that. I think it's very hard to know which of these are actually going to be important and tractable and be addressable in ways that will have benefit without adverse effects, but we won't know until we actually know something about effects of rare mutation. In doing this, of course, we also will begin to understand, and we ought to have on our to-do list, understanding the contribution of rare variation to every common disease. And we, again, will not know, this is an experiment, until we do the experiment, what the actual contribution to each individual disease will be. But rare variation with large effect is a very good roadmap for translating this insight into new therapeutics. And to translate this into new therapeutics requires that the deep knowledge that we have in biomedical science actually gets thrown over, thrown through the pipeline, over the wall, or in some way connects to pharma. We do not make drugs in academia, but we are the storehouse of tremendous amounts of knowledge. Pharma is a tremendous storehouse for understanding medicinal chemistry and how to make drugs and do effective clinical trials, but they do not have the knowledge of biology that we do. And we need to make sure that the Bohr connecting knowledge in academia and knowledge in pharma is a wide open one, and that these connections are effectively made. And my experience has been that we generally in academia are quite naive about what is known in pharma and what it takes to actually get an obvious target to all of us in academia actually effectively prosecuted in industry. So if you think about starting from there, where this is likely to go, I think it's clear that we will be using DNA sequencing as a means of diagnosis and strategies for stratifying therapeutics to a substantial extent. But that will depend in large part on what the results of these experiments are. We can talk about personalized medicine, and I think there are good paradigms that we heard about today in cancer, where knowing the specific mutation in an individual patient is critical to picking the right drug. On the other hand, we know that we can prevent heart attack and stroke in millions of people by lowering cholesterol and lowering blood pressure without any knowledge of a patient's individual genotype. So I think it remains an open question as to which model is going to apply on a disease-by-disease basis. And until we know the contribution of rare variation to an individual's particular disorder, we really won't know whether personalized medicine is going to be something that everyone ought to have their genome sequenced to try to predict their susceptibility, or whether we simply should be focusing on finding the right targets, making good medicines, and expecting that we're going to be able to treat a very large fraction of the population with those drugs, as has applied to the cardiovascular model today. I think further that people frequently accuse we geneticists of being reductionists. And why aren't we paying more attention to the environment? Well, one of the obvious reasons is that the genome is now a bounded problem. We know the 3 billion bases of the human genome, and there are essentially no more. And so this is a spectacular way to begin to approach the problem, not with the expectation that the environment is not important, but once we start identifying the genes and the pathways that are perturbed in disease, this provides the best opportunity for looking for environmental interactors, and our work in hypertension is a beautiful example of that, I think. Once you know that all these genes are affecting salt handling in the kidney, well, one of the environmental components, obviously, you ought to be thinking about salt. I expect there will be many more such interactions that will emerge from these genetic observations. So, lastly, I'll think thinking a little bit further over the event horizon as to what might be happening later on, and maybe not so much later on from recent developments. I think there are several questions that have to be on our to-do list. One is, how do we read genomes? Today we can say there are 21,000 genes and here they are, and we know a little bit about what their biochemical functions are. And once you get out outside the protein coding region, we know virtually nothing about what's important in the human genome and what modulation of those parts of the human genome would actually do. And a nice example of that is if we were to give everyone in this room the DNA sequence of the 44 vertebrate and mammalian species that people commonly refer to, and say which is which, we would have almost no ability to do that today unless we had a scorecard to refer to. We need to really understand why it is that the genome of a mouse is what it is, the genome of a fish, and the genome of an elephant. What are the critical differences, and how does DNA sequence translate into the spectacular varieties of morphology that we see? And then lastly, I'll mention that, again, further over the event horizon, just in the last several years, we're starting to see the possibility of really transformative biology that further down the road, I think, is likely to have considerable opportunity, and that's genome engineering. And when I refer to genome engineering, I don't mean it in the Orwellian fashion, but I mean in the sense of individuals with severe inherited disorders. It is far from beyond imagination today that we're going to be able to correct these mutations. And there are clearly myriad obstacles to achieving this, but the ability to actually target specific mutations with systems such as CRISPR that have just come online in the last couple of years, I think have profound implications. And if you think about where we were 40 years ago when I started as a graduate student and where we're likely to be 40 years from now, it's hard for me to imagine that we won't have translated much of this information into new therapeutics. So I'll stop there.
Terrific. Thanks. Thank you so much. And let me just make sure the audience knows, as I'm calling on our last prize winner, that I'm about to ask you for questions. So you students know that I may call on you. So last but definitely not least, Jim Allison has been recognized for the discovery of T-cell checkpoint blockade as effective cancer therapy. So I feel like he needs a little introduction giving the newspapers these days, but let me tell you his background. He received his undergraduate degree and his PhD from UT Austin, did a postdoc fellowship at Scripps, and his first faculty appointment and current faculty appointment is at MD Anderson. He was at University of California, Berkeley, where he was director of the Cancer Research Laboratory and initiated his studies on CTLA-4 and checkpoint blockade. He moved to Memorial Sloan Kettering in 2004, where he was director of the Ludwig Center for Cancer Immunotherapy and is now chair of immunology at the MD Anderson Cancer Center since 2012. He's received numerous awards, notably the Economist 2013 Innovation Award and the first AACR-CRI Lloyd Old Award in Cancer Immunology in 2013. He recently received an AACR Stand Up to Cancer Cancer Immunotherapy Dream Team grant, for which he'll serve as the Dream Team leader. So Dr. Allison, can you help us understand all the buzz about cancer immunology, and more importantly, where's this all going over the next decade?
I'll try, Susan. Thanks for the introduction. I want to so thank Yuri and the foundation for this great honor. It hasn't quite sunk in yet, but I suppose in a few little while it will. So I work in the area in immunology, basic immunology, and have dabbled in tumor immunology for a long time. And one of the things that I found highly annoying and disappointing was, despite the fact that we knew that with a lot of detail that tumor antigens did, that tumors did express antigens that the immune system could detect in humans as well as in animal models. And we know how antigens are processed. We know a lot of the signals that are involved in getting antigens effectively presented to T cells. And yet, despite all that information, attempts to mobilize the immune system by therapeutic vaccination over the last three decades has really been a pretty dismal failure with not much happening. And so one of the things that I decided to do was pay a lot more attention to the basic aspects of regulation of T cell responses, hoping that that would give some insight into the process. And so began that by working out the structure of the T cell antigen receptor, which is the molecule that the T cell uses to recognize antigens. And then it was known in the late 80s that there was another signal, a co-stimulatory signal that was needed to, as a sort of the gas pedal to get the T cells going. And we showed that was a molecule called CD28. When we cloned mouse CD28, there was a molecule in the databases that was already there called CTLA-4. It was highly homologous, but it really wasn't clear what it did. It was only known as a cDNA at that time. And a group in Seattle actually showed that it bound to the same ligands as CD28. But it differed in a couple of ways. One is it wasn't found in resting T cells. CD28 is on all the time. CTLA-4 is turned on only after activation, it increases with activation. And the second thing is it binds those ligands much, much higher, a couple of logs tighter than CD28. Anyway, there's a race to figure out what CTLA-4 did, and the first group that made an antibody to it actually concluded that it was another positive co-stimulatory molecule. And we got into the game a little bit later, and Jeff will remember this time well. We decided that about the same time that that wasn't correct, that this wasn't a positive molecule, that it was really an inhibitory molecule. And the reason people thought it was is when you put antibodies in, you were blocking a negative signal. And this was the first cell intrinsic negative signaling pathway found in T cells. Before that, they weren't known. And so when we realized that, decided it immediately occurred to me that that might be one of the reasons why repeated immunization would not be very effective in getting tumor immunity, because every time you gave the go signal, you'd also give the stop signal with time, and that eventually would paralyze the system and keep the T cells from working. So, that whole idea was fairly controversial, but we pursued it for really two main reasons. One of them, the compelling reason to pursue it, is you heard a lot today about, you know, cancer biology and driver mutations and passenger mutations. Well, the immune system doesn't actually care what the mutations are. It only cares if there's a change in a peptide. So the cancer biology here is, the immune system's agnostic as to that. So since you're treating the immune system and you're not treating the cancer cell, it had the potential at least to get working against all cancers. And the second thing was, what primes T cells is tumor cell death. And so as monotherapy, this might work just because of the death of tumor cells that might happen during the normal growth cycle, inflammation and cross-priming of T cells. But it also ought to increase the efficacy of virtually anything that kills tumor cells. And so to me, it just sounded like a good thing to try. And so we did an experiment and just gave mice transplantable tumor lines, gave them a couple of injections of this antibody that we made, and the tumors just disappeared in the mice. And it was a stunning result that I found it hard to believe at first. We had to repeat it. I made sure it was repeated and repeated blindly, in the sense that a student set it up and I measured the tumors on the mice without knowing what they were. And what we saw was that the tumors grew for a while and went away. And it was stunning, because all we're doing is covering up one molecule out of everything that's going on when you have an immune response started. We're covering up this one molecule that's a critical break of the immune system, and it results in tumor rejection. And we did a lot of different tumor models of mice and a lot of different strains of mice. And it would work as monotherapy sometimes, but we never found a tumor that it wouldn't work with if we combined it with the right thing, be that a vaccine or radiation or cryoablation or chemotherapy. And so after a while, we began to wear down the skeptics and teamed up with a company called Medirex that made a fully human version of the antibody, and then later with Bristol Myers Squibb. And went into clinical trials in 2001. first in melanoma, there was a 14-patient phase one trial, and of the 14 patients, three of them had objective responses. And one of them, at least, had a response after a single injection of the antibodies lasted 13 years. I met her a couple of years ago after her 10th anniversary of her being declared tumor-free after that single injection. She had no more treatments, no recurrence, just everything gone, and gone for 13 years. Anyway, so that led to a lot of investigation of it, and most of the predictions proved to be correct. Most of the treatment was in melanoma, but it also was used in prostate cancer, renal cancer, some lung cancer experience, pancreatic cancer even, and there were at least anecdotal responses of virtually every kind of cancer that it was tried in. Anyway, the drug became called ipilimumab, and if I can make light of that, when the FDA named it that, I tried to convince them to put an H in front of it in memory of my Berkeley days, but they didn't think that ipilimumab would be a good name for a drug, apparently, so that one didn't stick. Anyway, the highlight of all that was in 2010 when the reports of an 800-patient randomized placebo-controlled trial in late-stage melanoma was reported. And like many drugs, and you heard this from Charles today, the median survival moved over about 4 months as compared to the control. So that would have probably been enough to get it registered. But that wasn't the exciting thing. The exciting thing was the curve came down and then flattened out at about 23% and stayed there for 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 4.5 years. Then they ended the trial. And so this was a durable response, and that tail went out. There's been recently, a couple of months ago, there was a retrospective study of 5,000 melanoma patients who'd gotten the drug. And the bottom line is if a patient makes it for about 2.5 years, they're not going to have a recurrence, and they're not going to need retreatment. And again, it's about 20 to 25% of patients. And so that then led to the identification of more of these negative checkpoints. And the first one identified, it turns out there are about 10 of them now that we know pretty well. The first one to go into the clinic was one called PD-1. It works slightly differently. Doesn't matter, the net effect is the same. It blocks responses. And so it also has shown responses in melanoma, renal cancer, lung cancer, breast cancer, some other cancers. And again, with a response rate of between 20 and 30% in all those cancers. The durability isn't known yet because it's only been around for about 3 years. But results of the early trials of that were reported in 2012 at ASCO. But this past year in June, there was a trial of a combination of the two of those antibodies together. And it was known from previous work that patients who didn't respond to CTLA-4 blockade would respond to PD-1 and vice versa, so they were non-overlapping subsets. But when you put the two together, the response rate in metastatic melanoma, the objective response rate was 50%. And so they're additive. And this was pretty stunning because a type of cancer that was essentially a death sentence 5 years ago, now 50% of the patients can respond just by combining these two antibodies in a single type of injection. It's repeated 4 times at 3-week intervals. So that's kind of where the field stands now, and it looks pretty exciting, and that's why there's been a resurgence in interest in this. And what we've got now are two types of therapies, the targeted therapies that you heard about, where you go after the driver mutation, where you get large fraction of the patients responding, but they tend to develop resistance, and you have to do something else, the combinations that you heard about, as opposed to this kind of therapy, when a minority of patients respond, but if they respond, the immune system provides memory, and you've got that memory for the rest of your life, basically. And so they're very durable responses. So what we've got to do now is get that tail on the curve up. It was 25% with each of those. Now it's at 50% for melanoma. So what we got to do is raise that tail and get it as close to 100% as we can in many more kinds of tumors. And that's what the goal of this field is today. And I want to echo something Charles said, is we should not be satisfied anymore with these 2 or 6 months extensions and median survival in a trial at great expense. What a demand that there'd be durable responses before FDA approval of drugs. And there's several ways of going about this that are obvious, some of them are not so obvious. One of them is combination, as I mentioned. We've done a lot of work with combinations of standard therapies in mice, and most of them seem to work. And that's beginning to happen in humans. Another thing is to combine them with the targeted therapies. That's a no-brainer in my mind. You can get one level of personalization by knowing how to target the tumor by hitting its lesion, its driver mutation, and then add the immunotherapy on top of it and give the durability then by priming against the antigens that are dumped out. So that hasn't really happened yet, but is going to happen soon. You can combine more of these negative ones, as I mentioned, PD-1 and anti-CTLA-4 work well. There's some other ones, B7-H3 and H4, that we're working on that, again, work by different pathways. And so we've got a lot of combinations we can try to get it up. But there's two things that I'm really excited about. One of them, Bert kind of mentioned today, there's the mutanome that we think is the target of most T-cell responses that are effective. And by the mutanome, I mean both the passenger and the driver mutations that occur in tumor cells, because the immune system, again, doesn't know the difference. It just knows that they're there. And so potentially, if you've got 40 mutations in a tumor cell line, and Bert told you we calculated theoretically 10% mostly could be presented by a single MHC molecule in people. You've got multiple targets then, so you can turn the single target of a genomically targeted therapy into many targets by blocking these negative signals and enhancing the immune system. But a variation of that that Bert and I have talked about a lot and we're trying to get going is just specifically targeting the mutanome. And by that I mean, this was something that wasn't possible when we first wrote about it, 6 or 7 years ago. But now it's beginning to be possible, and that's to sequence the genome, or at least sequence the RNA that's made in a tumor cell, compare it to the exome sequencing of the patient's blood cells, normal cells, and identify all of the mutant peptides that exist in the genome, and just again agnostically then make the peptides, take T cells from the patients, see which peptides they recognize, and the ones they recognize then make a cocktail and combine that with the checkpoint blockade, and then you can target the immune system of the patient on the things that you know are there and they're beginning to see. And I think this will be a very powerful thing which is going to happen in a few years. And the final thing that I think is pretty exciting. It's not very far along yet, but it comes out of some work that our colleague Pam Sharma did, showing that when you block CTLA-4, there's a molecule called ICOS, inducible co-stimulator, is expressed on a population of CD4 T cells. I don't get too technical, but anyway, it's another co-stimulatory molecule. So you block CTLA-4, and then you've got potentially a new target, which Pam's lab and mine shown is really critical to the optimum clinical effect of anti-CTLA-4. And we've also shown in a model system that you can target that positive molecule after blocking the negative molecule. So you give an inhibitory molecule to the negative checkpoint and then an agonistic antibody to the positive one, and you can make the whole system work much better. And so I think the future there is mostly, as I see it, well, the obvious things are being done. But I think we need to start doing more clever combinations, identifying more of these positive signals. But the most important thing probably is to identify biomarkers, because right now we don't know how to predict which patients are going to respond. And so there's a lot of inefficiency built into the system.
Okay, I'm going to cut you off.
Okay.
That was fantastic. Before I open for questions, please join me in congratulating an awesome group of prize winners for 2014. I had to wait till you took a breath. That was terrific. Thank you to all the folks. So I'm going to ask the panelists, too, if they have any comments or questions for their colleagues. But before I turn to the panelists, questions, comments from the audience? We have some microphones. Please ask for a microphone.
Hi. Great panel. We've heard, you know, we keep hearing about how the age of somebody getting their first R01 is going up and the NIH funding lines are going down. And I wanted to ask you, what's harder and easier about making it in science now than it was when some of you were talking about science careers that went back 40 years?
Who wants to comment on that? Go ahead.
There is actually... Obviously, you ask a complex question,
But there is a way to make a conical section, as mathematicians call such things, and kind of simplify the question, perhaps artificially, but it does eliminate an important aspect of it. And that is, there are two ways to look at one's quote-unquote career. I'm not even sure I understand that word. And that is, one is to worry about what will happen to you as a practicing professional, where will be bread on your table or other things which are obviously important in everyday's life. And another thing is not to care about it at all. And that is not to consider this a profession. That's actually kind of an unusual way to look at it, but it was natural to me all my life. It's not a profession. It's what I would do with, obviously, I would be annoyed if I'm not paid for it, because I do have to eat, but I would still do it. So it's not a profession, in some deeper sense of the word. And therefore, if it's not a profession, I always felt that, well, if I would be good at what I'm doing, I will always have some kind of lab, an ability to do work collaborating with my colleagues. And if I'm insufficiently good at it, but still love it, I will have at least a bench for myself in somebody else's lab. Nothing fundamentally wrong with that either. So one way to look at it, of course, is to worry about such things all the time, and it's a perhaps rational response to pressures of everyday's life. And another way is to disregard it completely. And interestingly enough, psychologically at least, that was a solution that I always found very natural.
Yes, Michael.
I absolutely agree with what Alec just on.
Are you agreeing with it that it's good to eat?
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah, we're all getting hungry.
Me too.
Well, yeah. I think I don't view what I do as a profession. It's a lifestyle, and it's something which it'll take care of itself, just like Alec said. But I'd also like to say it's a global endeavor. I mean, I hear everybody here complaining about the funding situation in America, but who applies for jobs outside of America? I mean, there are lots of jobs all over the world. We're a global profession. Look elsewhere. That's all I'd say.
Anyone else want to comment on that? I know that's an important issue to our audience.
Sure.
Go ahead. Yeah.
Well, obviously a critical question. I agree very much. I also think that these prizes have the opportunity and certainly in part the ambition to increase the public awareness of science. And I think this is really critical. I think we've learned that we as scientists are not an effective lobby in any sense of the word, and Congress has learned that there's absolutely no penalty for cutting public funding for science. And I think we need to do a better job of conveying to the public the ability to connect the dots between basic science and advances in human health. And I think this is really a critical element for us as a field, both to ensure our own future, but also for subsequent generations. Because I think at a time when we have unprecedented opportunities in basic science, it would really be a tragedy to lose the momentum that we have, both here in the US, but also around the world.
So, Bob, can I ask you a question that's related to this? As the engineer on the panel, how do you think about life sciences, engineering, big data, in terms of how you think about those coming together in this balance of doing important work and the calling versus a career?
Yeah, well, I think it's wonderful. And actually, Eric Lander, is Eric here? But he actually, I think, at the Broad Institute, that's a terrific example of doing that kind of work. But I think there's so many places where that's just a gigantic future. So I think it's a wonderful career. I see so many people. In fact, even this was announced last night, you're going to have the next prize in math. I mean, math's a good example of where people are doing that kind of thing, and I think it's great. And what's happening you know, Phil Sharp and I wrote an article in Science a couple of years ago on this whole idea of convergence. And the whole point is to get engineers and biologists working together. So in our building, which both Phil's on the fourth floor, I'm on the sixth floor, but, you know, half the building are engineers, half the building are biologists. And, you know, we're working together on all kinds of problems, including the ones I said, like, you know, can you create ways to deliver things like siRNA into cells and, you know, new kinds of sensors. And I think that that's just a giant area for the future.
Sandy.
This marvelous event in the last couple of days has just been terrific. So thank all of you who've had a hand in this. But it causes me to reflect on a kind of curious and in some ways sad contrast. A few miles down the road, Silicon Valley, the world was changed irrevocably. There's no question about it. And some of the leaders and shakers and movers of that revolution are behind this great prize. And yet, if you look at the life sciences, despite the wealth of terrific science that's coming out, nothing similar has happened yet. And the public certainly perceives it differently. Our government doesn't value what we do very much. Investors don't value what we do very much, at least at early stages. So unless this sort of macro question is too off the wall, I'd appreciate some comments on what is the difference? Is it that the problems are just too hard, or is there something we're not doing right that fueled the Silicon Valley revolution? I want a life science revolution of comparable impact on the world.
Maybe Richard Lifton, do you want to comment on that? You talked a little bit about...
Gee, thanks, Susan.
You can pay me back when I least expect it.
So I'll start by saying biology is really hard. And I think that's obvious to everyone in this room. And yet, I think it would be a real mistake to think that we have not made really important advances in understanding human biology and disease in just the last decade. And so if you reflect on where we were when the HIV epidemic hit here in San Francisco in the early 1980s, this was a devastating disease that there was essentially no opportunity to prevent loss of life in relatively short order, and this is now a manageable chronic disease. This clearly would not have happened without public support for science. If you look at the discoveries that we've heard about in cancer and cardiovascular medicine, the tremendous reduction in burden in the cardiovascular system and the promise of what's happening in cancer, again, none of this would have happened without fundamental understanding of biology that has come from publicly funded science. And I think Congress, even the most skeptical, have long recognized that the public investment in science has to be connected through to development in industry that requires industry. I don't think the assumption has ever been that this is all going to happen in academia. So I think, you know, the paradox really to me is that we're in one of the most remarkable periods of discovery and understanding of biology that extends across the entire biological world, and at the same time we're facing public, certainly governmental reductions in funding. I think all of the polls reflect that science is held in generally very high regard by the public, and I'd really think if you compared our favorability ratings to those of Congress, we come out on a pretty strong side of that equation.
That's a low bar. Let me ask Dr. Varshansky to comment on that question.
I just wanted to, I don't think I will contradict anything that has been said in regard to that question. It's just that my perspective perhaps would come across as slightly unusual. And that is, I remember about history. Go back only about 160, 170 years ago, Michael Faraday, the future great physicist, was working as an apprentice in a bookbinder shop and went to listen to Humphrey Davis talk at the Royal Society, and being totally impressed with the talk, He couldn't even approach Devi because he was from low classes and he had no access to somebody like Devi. But he wrote the lecture that he remembered verbatim, and being a bookbinder, made a very fancy, beautiful presentation of that lecture and asked for permission to give it to Davy. And of course, the rest is history, because Michael Faraday proved to be even greater physicist than Davy ever was. And this was only about 160 and 170 years ago, when mostly gentlemen of means could afford to do science. Now, I look at our current times and I'm amazed. Almost everyone who is totally, completely committed to our quote-unquote profession, almost everyone can enter it and possibly even prosper in it, depending on the how requited is that love, which of course is not something to discuss in rational terms, because it's a question of luck, the question of abilities. But entering the subject, unlike Faraday's time, is not forbidden to anyone. And it's such a great, tremendous advance, and the fact that there are so many of us, which is of course what creates problems that we are discussing, it's actually something to celebrate, not necessarily to be depressed about. And that's all I wanted to say.
You know, I thought I was a glass half full kind of gal, but you got me beat, man. You're great. Go ahead, Michael.
We've heard two questions tonight, and both have been rather pessimistic. I'm much more optimistic. I think that there's a lot of opportunity out there. You know, you just have to go out and get it. I think it's really a wonderful profession, and there are lots of things to be done. It really is. I mean, you should be really happy with what you do.
Yes. I didn't mean my question to be pessimistic.
Yeah, I don't think Sandy's a pessimist. There's a hand up in the back. Yeah.
Well, what is clear, though, that I think we'd have to look for new funding mechanisms, because until things change in Congress, it's not going to be the NCI. So it's going to be foundations, it's going to be charitable endeavors. Hopefully the drug companies will realize that if the basic science engine dries up, they're sunk too. So they need to start investing in more research.
Just to comment on that, I think it's an interesting point that why is industry not more supportive of NIH funding? This has been a huge problem, and it's obviously clear that the industry vitally depends on basic science, basic funding of research, and yet industry has been very reluctant to get into the fray to call for greater NIH funding, federal funding, just across the board. We had a meeting must have been 7-8 years ago, Society for Neuroscience organized to try to bring together industry, all the stakeholders. We didn't organize the whole thing, but were involved with this meeting, and it was very clear that Nobel Prize winners and everybody was on the same page, and the industry was there, but absolutely nothing came of it, even though a great deal of talk was generated. I think that's an area that really should be emphasized in these discussions. We're in the best of times in terms of tools and resources and things we can do. It's the worst of times in terms of funding and support, and we're losing. It's not just short term, it's long term. We're losing a lot of graduate and postdocs who are going other directions. They see how difficult it is to get funding. I'm not half empty, but I just think that's the reality. That's the reality of the situation. It's urgent that something be done creatively to move the needle.
Thank you. I'm going to give you the last question. No pressure.
Thank you. Well, I'm just a first-year student, and this kind of event is really eye-opening for me. Well, as I'm just pondering over like my possible future careers, I have noticed that your names are often linked to like your biggest discovery through your life, and that's obviously very, very great. But is there any time point in your life that you think, well, maybe I can move on to something else. Maybe I can make an equivalent important discovery in that small other field. Or maybe do you think, is there some time when you think you're ready or the field is ready so you can move on to something else? Thank you.
So the question is about switching direction, changing gears. Does anyone want to comment on that? Have any of you switched gears? And Jim?
Yeah, one of the most important things to learn is when to quit working on something. You know, you can't keep bashing your head. And when you realize that something's intractable, you've got to move on or you're going to ruin your career. I mean, it's just equally.
So how do you know that? Particularly somebody who, you talked about cancer immunology. That would be one of great despair, I mean, as recent as 10 years ago.
Yeah, well, you just take a different approach, look at it a different way.
I think one of the ways you do that is by encouraging people from somewhat different fields than the one that you're most comfortable in to join you in doing new things. And so, as someone who likes solving genetic and genomic puzzles, I've always kept an open door to people who are working in very different fields. And one example is a fellow who came to Yale after training as a pediatric psychiatrist, who realized that very little was happening in his field in fundamental science. And he came to Yale to do a PhD in the hopes that he would learn something about how to approach these very difficult problems in psychiatry. And he was a smart guy and thought, well, shoot, we ought to help support him in his career ambitions and development. And he's gone off and has been one of the real fundamental movers in understanding the genetic contributions to autism. And as much as we were sorry to see him leave Yale, he's now here as chair of psychiatry at UCSF. So I think, you know, these are examples of how you can both change somewhat your own directions, but also try to amplify your efforts by being open to working in other areas.
Yeah. Go ahead.
I might just give you a personal example, which is a little bit different, but I mean, and actually very consistent with some of the things you heard earlier. So as I mentioned, I was a chemical engineer, and when I got done with my degree, in 1974, my doctorate, pretty much every chemical engineer, there was that when they sort of had that kind of gas shortage then. So pretty much every chemical engineer I knew, and everyone at MIT, they went to work in an oil industry. And so I remember going to have interviews there. And actually, I got 20 job offers. I mean, 4 from Exxon alone. And, you know, and it wasn't like I was that great or anything, but they just had so many job offers. So I remember going down there and they said, you know, gee, this would, if you could just increase the yield of this one chemical by 0.1%, they said that would be fantastic. It'd be worth billions. And I remember flying back to Boston that night thinking to myself that I really didn't want to do that. I just thought it was boring. I wanted to do something important. And I didn't know what it was, but I knew what it wasn't. And ultimately, as was mentioned, I was lucky enough, I started applying to different kinds of jobs, and I once wrote to a hospital, and well, actually all the hospitals turned me down too, but Judah Folkman was kind enough to offer me a job, and I just thought that the kinds of things that he was doing, and you know, and people heard from Napoleon earlier today about, you know, some of where that ultimately led to because of the terrific work that he and Genentech did, but to me, that was just something really exciting that I felt it could change the world. And so what I did is I just followed my passion. And I think what you heard actually from everybody on this stage is that's what they've done too, one way or the other. I mean, even if things look bad, you keep following your passion. And the opposite is also true. If something doesn't strike you as exciting or important, don't do it. So it's somehow it's just following your heart. It's kind of a simple rule. But I think that's what you heard from a lot of people in different ways. And, you know, that was kind of how I thought about it.
Well, again, I want to thank this incredible panel, and I want to thank all of you. It is Friday afternoon right before the holidays, and here you all are. We had more than 1,500 people online watching the streaming video today, so it's been a wonderful celebration of science. Thank you all. Thank you, Yuri. Thanks to all of you for coming. There's a reception outside. And please join us for a reception out in the atrium, just outside the wooden doors. Mm-hmm.